Good news in the world of disease. They have found a protein that stops the reproduction of the AIDS virus. They found it in pregnant woman's urine. I'm not kidding about this. I wouldn't. It's not funny. Pregnant woman's urine. So I don't know how this happened, but they made the discovery during the shooting of Madonna's last video. Don't ask me. Don't ask me. Now, this story from Jonesboro, Arkansas, just gets worse and worse all the time. Now they are saying, this came out today just before we went on the air, that the 13-year-old boy who shot the girls, they say he was in his father's house in Michigan last summer, and that he inappropriately touched a girl. And he's in trouble for that. You think he was in trouble for the shooting. Now Ken Starr wants a piece of him. And speaking of that trouble, finally, the former Miss America, Elizabeth Ward Grayson, the actress, has come forward now. She was forced to say what happened with President Clinton. She said she had sex with him after flirting in his limousine when he was governor of Arkansas in 1982. Now, don't get this. You're governor of Arkansas, and you get to do Miss America in the limo. Then you're the president, and you're humping the fat chick who does... I mean, Ken Starr, hasn't this man suffered enough? I don't understand. I think it is important to note, to go on the record, to say that Miss America, former Miss America, said that absolutely that the sex with President Clinton was consensual. But she said she got damn tired of him singing, "Here She Comes, Miss America." She's a columnist for Human Events, an attorney with the Center for Individual Rights, and Coulter, and where are you? And a pirate. That's quite a fashion statement. He's a former prosecutor and the author of Helter Skelter. His new one is No Island of Sanity, Paula Jones versus Bill Clinton, the Supreme Court on trial. Vincent Bugliosi, yeah. Nice to meet you, sir. The charming star of Hercules, the legendary Journeys actor slash demigod, Kevin Sorbo. Hey, Kevin, how you doing? Nice to meet you. And finally, his films include Diner, City Slickers, and Home Alone. His next is Tourist Trap on this week's Wonderful World of Disney, Daniel Stern. Hey, Daniel, great to meet you. How you doing? Okay. All right, I'm going to show you a couple of pictures to start the show tonight. We have this one in still store. This is little Andrew Golden, who was implicated in the murder in Jonesboro, Arkansas. There he is at 6 years old with a rifle that he was given from Santa Claus. Isn't that nice? And that's such a good Christmas gift because, you know, when you have that gift, you can get the bicycle, you can get the TV. You can get all the gifts you want, can't you? Now look at that picture. I want you to look at that picture for a second. Now look at another picture. Okay, remember her? Do we see any similarities here, is my first question to the panel. Deputizing young children into adulthood. Lipstick on the girls, guns for the boys, which is worse.
A little creepier than the boy is. I don't see what the big deal is with little kids.
Having guns at
guns.
Six, like that, the gun
yeah,
bigger.
Yeah, no, I mean it happens all over.
How'd you lose your eye?
Okay. Oh, took exactly 10 seconds.
She was more concerned about that, but I said it looks really cool, so it matches the outfit.
It's kind of odd to be bringing up. How do you make the connection? Except that they were.
They look the same. They look like people, adults who put them in little adult uniforms and giving adult accoutrements that they shouldn't have.
The little kids always play with guns. I don't think he looks like an adult.
Real guns. Yeah, that was a real one.
All over Idaho, all over Colorado, all over the South. Everybody has guns.
I grew up in the Midwest. I grew up in Minnesota, and all my friends who had guns. I mean, there's deer hunting and there's duck hunting. Everybody did it. I didn't do it. But there's, I'm going to get in this whole of the battle with NRA or whatever, but there's something wrong with the way we let people just have guns, I think. I think there's something has to be done, but how can you control it? How can you control it?
We're all in favor of gun control. The only problem is...
We're not all in favor of gun control.
The
NRA is not in favor of gun control, I promise you.
They would be if everyone turned their guns. But the problem is criminals are not going to turn their guns. Only the law-abiding are. So that's a big problem.
Well,
the problem
with
the NRA, if everyone turned in their guns, they may go along with it.
No, because they're trying to... That's a political organization. They're basically buying the votes. I don't think it has to do with... It has to do with the... I mean, the NRA gets into campaign finance, financing the votes and buying the votes in Congress more than the morality of it, I think.
But I don't understand. Whenever you people talk about gun control, it's always after some incident where gun control wouldn't have done anything. Like here, the kid broke into his grandfather's house. His grandfather's a game warden. He has these guns on the wall. I mean, it's not like he went to a store and because he didn't have to show ID was able to purchase a gun at 10 years old.
He was raised
in his grandfather did.
Yes.
The guns are there. The grandfather had to buy the guns.
Gun control isn't going to stop game wardens from having guns in their home.
I think
it would be a stupid idea anyway, but it would just have nothing to do with what happened here. He still would have gotten the gun from the game warden.
There were other two school shootings in the last year that didn't involve game wardens.
No, and you know what else?
Probably five
that's
more.
That's not a trend, you're right.
But none of them involved anything.
He didn't need 12 guns to be a game warden.
I don't understand why this Jonesboro shooting, within 10 seconds, everybody's all over the airwaves with whatever their little pet cause is, saying it's either, violence on TV or it's guns. I mean, I feel like I should be saying it's these, confiscatory tax rates that led to this shooting. There's evil in the world. You just have to face the fact that there's evil.
Oh, that's so silly.
it's evil.
It ends up on television, so it ends up being a television issue. It ends up being more fodder for,
because there's violence in TV shows.
So we should just throw up our hands and not look for the causes of evil?
No, but people are on TV saying that. What I'm saying is everyone's taking whatever their pet cause is and saying, if you had listened to me.
It's not a pet cause. It's a root problem. There's a difference.
Evil
We're trying to find
problem.
The difference.
So
it doesn't happen again.
Well, maybe we should have maybe we should have a surgical operation on human nature, and that might solve the whole problem.
Right.
No. I'm just being cute.
I would so much more respect the gun lobby if they would just say, you know what? We love guns.
They're cool,
and we really don't care about the consequences. We just want them, and it's selfish, but we like them. People do selfish things. We love guns. Instead of saying, you know what? Guns don't cause the problem, because they do.
No question. Yes, they
did. Didn't hear.
They didn't hear.
No.
Well, he didn't shoot the other girl.
I don't understand why you can say this is guns any more than government schools. Every one of these schools where there's been a shooting, incidentally, hasn't been a private school. So, if you're looking for some sort of connection, this is the goofiest social science you people engage in, coming up with, one thing
guns
that's there.
Guns and death is not that bizarre a connection.
Thank
they
you.
Shot with guns.
Thank you.
What's the...
got the NRA magazine, you read monthly of all the citizens using guns to defend themselves. So, it's used to kill people. It's also used
when they're defending themselves, they're also killing people. Those are deaths.
Right, and that's a good use of a gun.
Of killing those people?
Yeah.
But most uses of a gun are not that. Most uses of a gun are domestic shootings.
No.
38,000 gun deaths in America.
No,
they're all in self-defense.
It's literally good,
which are the
like
good
every
killings?
3 minutes somebody is using a gun in self-defense. Most of the times, you hear about it only when the person is actually shot, but guns get brandished all the time, and the guy backs
good.
Off. That's
the brandishing is fine. Is that the point?
Right,
shut up, everybody! I got to go to commercial.
Planning to be in the Los Angeles area and would like free tickets to Politically Incorrect, call 213-852-2655 or visit our website at abc.com/PI.
All right. Well, the subpoenas went out yesterday in the Paula Jones case. That's always a happy day. And your new book, Counselor, is about that very case. And let me say what, if you don't know, last year, May 27th, Supreme Court ruled that the Paula Jones case did not have to wait until the president was out of office. And Justice Stevens says, it appears to us highly unlikely that this case will occupy any substantial amount of Clinton's time.
Well,
it's a... occupied a lot of all of our time. But can't we say that the Supreme Court completely blew it on this one?
Right. And strangely enough, though, before this book right here, The Line of Sanity, many people said, this is an unfortunate decision. It's going to hurt the office of the presidency. But these very same people, Dershowitz, Spence, National Law Journal, they all went on to say, however, comma, the court had no choice. They were legally correct. This book is pointing out they were legally incorrect. They came down with a ruling. I don't know if they were suffering from an intellectual hernia or what, but they came down with a ruling that's not only devoid of common sense, but here's the surprising thing, violates their own fundamental legal principles. What they didn't do here is something that they have to do unless they want to flip a coin. They didn't balance the public interest against the private interest. If
right.
they had done
Why
that,
does Paula okay. Jones...
Yeah, right. If they had done they, that, yeah, if they had done that, what conceivable argument under the moon can be made for the proposition that Paula Jones' individual interest to go to trial right now, right in the middle of the president's term...
I don't know.
is more important than the conflicting rights of 260 million Americans to have their president be undiverted in the performance of his duties. That question was never answered because it was never even asked.
Well, it's
four syllables. Let's see, incompetence, right? Four syllables. They didn't raise that issue. They argued separation of powers, which is a elegant argument.
I think you're out of touch, like so
but
many
a very
in
weak
Washington.
Argument. Yeah. But there's a second
that
public...
in Hollywood.
Okay, you've had your 30 seconds.
Okay, I'm sorry, go ahead.
Your long famous intellectual tradition for this, you know, goes back to the Tories, but they all fled to the Bahamas because we don't have a monarchy. That's why you can sue the president for something that is completely personal. I don't know how you could possibly draw a line otherwise. What if you rape someone in office? What if there's a child custody dispute? If you ever had a divorce, President?
Well, wasn't a difference between civil and criminal action?
Yeah.
I think there's a difference in what
happened. Going to come up with?
Wait! Did you hear what he said? There's a difference between civil and criminal. This is a civil suit. You were
alimony.
Talking about criminal.
I'm talking about alimony and child custody.
Now, you said rape.
I threw in three
Yeah, you threw in. You turned a blind eye to... Very good. To the difference between... This is a civil suit, and may I remind you that military personnel, even a sergeant, cannot be sued until while he's in the military. But the commander-in-chief can in a civil suit?
Well, that's because they're out of the country.
No,
they're not.
The theory is you can call away and don't fight in Germany in 10 minutes.
No, that is the theory. The Wartime Act, but even today, the Soldiers and Sailors Civil Relief Act of 1940, all lawsuits against members of the military, if they desire, automatically continue to the end of their tour of duty. Why? The statute spells it out. We want them to be able to concentrate full time on their military duties. So, Anne, you could have a situation, even today, we're not at war, where a buck private going through military training at Fort Benning, Georgia, whose principal challenge is to learn how to assemble and disassemble an M16 rifle, he's legally entitled to a continuance of that lawsuit, but the President of the United States, as you point out, has the most demanding, important job on the face of the earth, is not. Now, what previously recognized form of logic would allow that?
They've thrown off a king, and it's if you leave through a constitutional president,
that's not the issue.
The whole idea
he's a demigod, like Hercules. He's half man, half president
of the Bahamas,
right?
Don't have a king. It's not supposed to
what
be.
What do you think, Hercules?
I think they should leave the guy alone until he's out of his office. I mean, something like that.
There's the view of the god in the street.
Half god. But if you want to talk about... but if it's rape, if it's murder, if something like that, you want to talk about, that's a different story.
Well,
I mean, then he's gone for sure.
Actually,
if it's a crime, that further fortifies that we have to wait, because no president has ever been indicted. So we have to look to the framers' intent, right? And when we do that, we look to the Federalist Papers, 1788, Alexander Hamilton...
through them today, guys. We'll look at them in a second. I have to take a commercial. We will, but let me just take a break. Let's go back to the kid issue, because we were talking in the break, and I know you just got married.
What does that have to do with me, with kids?
Because you're going to have kids.
That's true.
You married Xena the Princess Warrior.
No, I did not.
But you said you thought, you know, there should be a license necessary to be a parent, which...
Well, we're talking about licenses that should be handed out, and I thought
gun licenses, parent.
There's a lot of parents out there that shouldn't be parents.
I don't know if it's necessarily licenses, but there's no time I have kids, 16 and 13, and there is no teaching that goes on. That's not valued in the education system. It seems like there's value in making kids who will be prepared for the job market, but not necessarily for people, adults who are going to have values or understand their feelings or things like that. That's not valued in
this kid's father said, I'm a good father, he's a good kid. Now, if this is a good kid, what is a bad kid?
Who knows where this kid picked this stuff up? I mean, let's face it, being in the entertainment industry for one
TV,
thing...
TV, Kevin.
Exactly.
Violence on TV.
That's part of the problem
There's a psychology that goes into him that we all we know is the picture that you just showed in any sort of news broadcast. Mm-hmm. We don't know his life. We don't know his parents. We don't know anything. That's the problem with most of the stuff on television is we're pretending that we know something that we know absolutely nothing about.
I mean,
and we end up all being experts on...
But, yeah.
On
kids.
That's true.
If you're growing up as a kid, you are a sponge, and you're a mirror image of what you see and what you relate to. When I grew up in the 60s, as I was a child in the 60s, and I remember watching the news with my parents in Vietnam War and seeing these dead bodies being dragged across. I mean, as that goes on, and it gets worse as time goes on with movies, television, what we're exposed to in everyday life, just regular news, what happens in Europe,
The difference in that time was that they were showing us something that was going on that affected our lives, and a lot of this has no effect on our lives. We could have been drafted... Our friends could have been drafted, that was information that we needed.
But my point is, it's the callousness that builds up over the years of having this happen. There's no respect for life anymore.
Everybody says this about... I'm not sure what the argument is here, but I think it's...
We're working for it. It's a statement
People have always said that about, you know, the Three Stooges and the Roadrunner, but I don't think there really is that much evidence for it. I think it does go back to the family. I mean, to the extent you can form a child at all, I think there is evil, and some people can be born evil, but the only thing we really have any evidence for how you can create an evil child is having an illegitimate child.
I'm not blaming.
There is no evidence for that.
I'm not blaming television.
80% of the prisoners in state penitentiaries, which are really bad crimes,
you don't think
are illegitimate.
Movies have any role in
it? I think it has something to do with it, no doubt, but I think parents have a bigger role in it. I think it's
because
how you've grown up.
Yes, they do.
They do. I mean,
but it seems like nowadays, as opposed to when you were talking about when we were kids, that the good guys are worse than the bad guys because they solve their problems with wanton violence too. This kid said, you know, I couldn't take anymore. That's what they all say. And that seems to be what all the action
heroes...
But it
also has to do with the easy... It's not just the violence part of it, but as a parent, everything on television has an easy answer. It's a lot of fast answers, a lot of easy answers, and that's not really happening in the real world. There's complicated answers to questions. There's sometimes no answer, or there's time needed to think of the answer. And so it's the instantaneous part of it as well as the violent part of it, I think, that's a problem, that looking for these spot-on answers. And the quickest way to that is a punch in the nose in the movies, and it's not necessarily
that. Well, if it was just a punch in the nose, that wouldn't be such a big problem, but when it's...
Right, well, it's thrown into
gun.
Going back to what you were saying about he's a good kid, you know, I prosecute these people for murder, and we get into the death penalty phase, and the issue was life or death, and the people would take the stand and say, wait a while, he's really a good kid. You're not going to hold these 10 seconds against him when he happened to murder 20 people.
Right.
I mean, if you remove those 10 seconds, he was a fine guy, you know what I mean?
Okay, we got to check a commercial. We'll come back.
Join us tomorrow when our guests will be Kate Ford, John Schneider, Jim Hightower, and Janet Parshall.
We were talking about kids and their role models, and if they have any. Now, Hercules, he's a
fine role model.
Buff Greek guy. A buff Greek man, he wears leather, travels with a male companion. Now, I'm just asking
what's wrong with that? We don't insinuate that at all.
No.
Not like that man.
But it,
exactly.
What are you saying about that man?
Don't you think that was always insinuated?
Now you're talking
Wasn't
about
that a gag Hollywood was playing on bourgeois America?
Yeah.
You're watching ABC.